So,
we learned yesterday about equilibrium, we learned about temperature scales, we talked a little bit about the lowest temperature recorded on Earth, we talked about how heat flows from hot to cold.
So today I told you I'd bring in this little laser gun, so we got this guy today. Okay.
Actually, it's a surface temperature monitor, infrared temperature gun. We've used this before. If you ever like for cooking, very good for cooking. So if you want the surface temperature of a steak, or a surface temperature of a steak that I need to meat, you want something like you're baking, like cookies, you want to know the temperature of the cookies without actually having an open oven. So in that case, you might have a problem with that. But you can get the surface temperature, something that's supposed to be the inner temperature of what you're cooking. It's also just good for applications in science. So what I thought we'd do to start, we're going to talk about modes of heat transfer. So I think last class I alluded to this already. So you walk down the hall from the beginning. Take your hand, feels pretty warm relatively speaking. Touch the desk, it feels pretty cold. Can I hold it there for about a minute? Hold it there for about a minute. Take your other hand and hold it up. Okay, so let's take a look and see what we got. 88, 86, 84, 84. 78. The knife isn't far away, it's got a little closer, so it's like 8. Your hand's a little cold, the surface. Make sure you
can see.
Are they cutting it cold?
No, mine is really hot right now.
84, not the one that was on the desk, only the other one, not the one on the desk. 89, 87, 86, 86, 85, 84.9. 77.3. Two of you.
Cold.
Much higher. 86. Did you just run the boat?
No, but I
thought you were originally I won one that was not on the table. So that, which was not on the table originally?
The
one that was on the table. Now, what happens when you put it on the table? Your hand is a little warmer than the table. The table temperature is 74. This table is 75. This table is 75. 76. Not really much difference, right? There is a difference, though, because they're not actually touching each other, that these tables are probably not the exact same temperature. If I take the temperature of the board, 75.6, the wall, 75.2, pretty close in general to each other, because the room temperature now is around 75.
Yeah. So pretty much everything in the room like evens out to the, whatever the temperature is?
Yeah, generally speaking, considering, yeah.
So
but it's still going to be variations.
Something yeah.
And it's a function of, which we're going to see in the next couple lessons, how easily some materials transfer heat, how readily they're able to transfer heat. We might call that the specific heat capacity. It's a term from chemistry that we're going to use in tomorrow's lesson or Monday's lesson. But what I want you to see, your hand's still there, right? Good, your hand's still there? Good. So we're going to use your example. So let's get the hand temperature, 87, 86. So it means not that much, pick it up right where your hand is, right here. 82. 88. So this desk was what? 74, 75? And now that one spot is 82. Your hand that was high 80s is still around 88. Your hand is not going to go down in temperature much because your body creates energy. You absorb energy by eating food, drinking water. Your body then does some sort of process on it. Your body is an operator, a function. Input is the food, output is the energy. Your body literally radiates energy regularly. Today we're going to talk about modes of heat transfer. Touching the desk is one mode. Your body giving off energy is another mode. The air conditioner blowing air all over you is another mode. There are three modes of heat transfer that we're going to refer to. So I want you guys to recognize that. Now, although I measured the desk right where you picked up your hand, if I measured it over here, and I'm doing it right now, it's still 76. But if you, yeah, you had it the whole time, did you move it? So 78.4, and then I go over here to the desk, 75.2. So you see a flux, a difference, right? So if I were to take a, I had a fire pit and I took a bunch of coals out of the fire and just drop the coals on the table right here, well, that heat would eventually spread throughout the table. But if this is like 90 degrees, it doesn't mean this has to be 90 degrees over here, even though it's one table, right? This might be 90, and this is like 89, 88, 87, 86, and that's what you're seeing as a flux. Change. Now, if you've looked at the Weather Channel before, you see what look like little rings. Ever seen that before? They use rings on the Weather Channel a lot. What kind of a graph is that? Anybody know?
Yeah, it's like a topographic where they use elevation, where they have the rings that come out from the top of the mountain outward. So they're really called isobars. It could be isobars for pressure, isotherms for heat. So the idea is that you might have some central object with 100 degrees Celsius as its temperature, and everything outward is a little bit less, more. So you put these rings around the centerpiece, and along that line, everything is 90 degrees. Along the next line, everything is 88 degrees. So it's literally a change in temperature radiating out from that central point. That's exactly what it is though. They do the same thing with pressure. When you're looking at storms on the Weather Channel, they'll say, hey, we have a low pressure center here, coming in from the west. If you look at it, you'll see around the low pressure center, they put isobars. It's the actual pressure around it. So a lot of scales are drawn with some sort of a gradient, a change from the inward out. Radially, if you want to use the right word, radially outward changes. Whatereas other things that we've drawn are graphs that are linear functions that change in time, right? This is something that changes as you move radially outward, okay? I forget the general phrase, if it's, because isobars are pressure, isotherms are temperature. The actual phrases for the little circles that go around, what the terminology is. Isolines? I don't know. Yeah. All right, so let's take a look at these modes here. So first, before we do that, let's recall what heat is from last class, so we know what we're doing this period. Heat, again, is energy that's transferred. Energy that's transferred. Why did your hand transfer energy to the desk? Why? Why did your hand transfer energy to the desk? Yeah. In this case, where did it go? From who to you to the desk, or the desk to you? Exactly. From the person's hand to the desk was the direction of heat transfer. Okay, again, you touch the desk, your hand is hotter than the desk, so it will transfer heat readily to the desk. Now, yesterday I alluded to this. The desk is about the same temperature as the whiteboard, which is about the same temperature as this metal ledge, which is the same temperature as this wall. Yet the metal ledge feels the coldest out of all four. This feels cold, right? This one feels a lot colder if you actually touch it. But they're about the same surface temperature. Why does this one feel so much colder? Steve? Say again? Good. I say good. Let's use another word for it, okay? No? No, it's good. Jack dancing on?
No.
No?
It's fine.
Oh, I see. So you said that they're a good conductor. Let's use the word thermal conductor. Because what is the other kind of conductor we talked about? Electric conductors. So we talked about how metal is a good conductor and rubber is a good insulator for electricity. Now, for heat transfer, it's not the same for the materials, but it happens to be that metal is another good conductor. Metal is another good conductor. How many of you like science fiction fantasy books? Anybody read like Game of Thrones-esque books, or Lord of the Rings, or any of those kind of books? There's a book I'm reading now, if you're interested in that, that involves metal, why metal is so important. It's called, it's a trilogy called Mistborn, M-I-S-T-B-O-R-N. If you're into sci-fi, fantasy, powers, Harry Potter kind of stuff, honestly, overthrowing empires and that kind of, like, you know, really good book. Talks a lot about metals. And they actually do a ton of physics in the book, not on purpose, but they talk about, like, different types of metal, have different reactions with the body and using those powers, but specifically metals. Metals are really important. Okay, good conductors of both electricity and heat. Electricity and heat. Now, the temperature difference is why you feel it. But the actual material property makes you feel it more or less. So I feel a little bit chilly on my cold on my hand when I touch the desk, but I feel more cold on my hand when I touch the ledge. Either way, though, there is a temperature difference. It's just that this one feels more because it conducts my heat better. It literally sucks my heat away better than the desk does. Okay, better than the desk does. So this is what we're seeing in the diagram. We talked about this yesterday with a can of soda. You put a can of soda in ice water,
What happens is the heat from the soda propagates outward. Because the ice water is colder, the soda is warmer. So the soda gives off its heat, the ice absorbs the heat. So eventually what happens to the ice, over enough time, the cooler the ice starts to? Starts to?
The ice
becomes warmer, the soda becomes warmer. Yes, the ice starts to melt, is what I'm saying, very good. So the heat from the soda goes into the ice, which raises the temperature of the ice, eventually melts. That's a phase change. We'll talk about that in the next section. A phase change. But we can see that with the molecules. Here's the juice. The molecules inside the juice. This right here is the aluminum can wall. This is the ice water. More temperature means these are higher average kinetic energy, so they're moving quicker. The can wall, not as high of temperature, moving a little slower. The soda, or the ice water, is very cold. These molecules are not moving fast at all. Now, look at the temperature gap. 40 degrees temperature gap. 40 degrees. So why isn't it meeting halfway? Why isn't it reaching equilibrium at 25? Isn't 25 halfway between these? 25 is 20 above this and 20 below this. So 25 makes sense to me, but somehow they reach equilibrium at 11 degrees. How come? How come? Take a guess. I don't know. Take a guess.
Some of it is transferred to the, some of it might be transferred to the metal. That's spreading.
Part of it goes into the metal, the can, but the can is then touching ice. So it definitely goes into the metal, but that goes into the ice anyway.
There's more water than juice, so the temperature will be closer to the line of the water than the juice.
Think about it. There's a ton of ice in that cooler, but only one little can, right? So you're going to get all this heat from the can. And it's not going into just a little bit of ice, it's going into a lot of ice. So each little bit of ice only gets a little bit of heat. So the overall temperature of the ice only goes up a little, from 5 to 11. 6-degree change. Yet here, 45 to 11. We're talking about 34 degrees in change. So the mass of the object that is transferring or receiving the heat impacts the final temperature they reach at equilibrium. We're going to see a lot of this in the next section, but I want you guys to visually understand it before we get into the math. Today's lesson is going to be all conceptual. No math in this lesson today. It's all conceptual. Tomorrow is all math. Not all math. It's mainly math, but there's conceptuals. Or Monday, I guess, not tomorrow. What else? Okay, so the heat flux lines are drawn outward here. But here we can see we're looking like biconditionals, meaning energy is coming in but going out, meaning there are balance. Okay, on the right is equilibrium. Anything else from that I want to mention? No. So let's take a look at our tables real quick for units. We have already talked about these units. In this course, we've used joules all year. We also, if you recall, we talked about power and energy running and stuff, and you convert the calories to see how much calories it burns by running up the stairs and going back down. So we came up with a conversion factor between joules and calories, and here it is, right here. This is the unit, not this. If you want to, maybe you can just put a cross through this. This is not what calories are that we use. This isn't like older physics and chemistry. This is not the unit that we use today. We use calories as far as the nutritional calorie. So this is the number, this is the same numbers, right? Oh, sorry, these two are the same numbers here. So if you have the word kilocalorie, or calorie with a capital C is also a kilocalorie, it means the same number as this, because it's kilo, it's times 10 to the third. This is what we know as a calorie of food. So you go home today, right? And you get home and you're craving some Twinkies. Ooh. You know the Twinkies? No one? Alright, I know they're terrible for you, but some foods that are bad for you still do taste good. How about Snickers? Or who likes candy bars? You got candy bars? Alright, Snickers? Is that a good one? No? Yes? Okay. Reese's? Yes.
Peanut butter? No, I still don't.
Okay, Reese's. Peanut Cat Crunch. Twix, the cooked crunch? So you go home, right? You decide, I want to eat a Snickers bar, right? You look at the label. On the Snickers bar, it says, what? 100 calories, maybe? A Snickers bar, probably around 100? Twinkies, those kind of things, are like 300. So it's a lot. So you eat, say you eat Snickers bars. 90 calories, right? 90 calories. You can convert that into joules, or you can physically determine body is able to use that food to regulate your body temperature. Your body temperature internally should be 98.6. Your skin temperature is obviously not the same. You guys just saw that, right? Your skin temperatures range like cold blood ones, 78.8 to a room, and then it was like 85 up to 88 something, right? So it's a range, honestly, though. It's usually like 75 to 90 is what I get for like student surface skin temperatures with that. But the idea of your body core temperature needing to be a certain temperature is where you get that energy is food. You eat food, you have caloric intake, that caloric intake changes. Your body does work on the food, and it literally sucks out the energy of the food. Everything else you get rid of, obviously.
So, like, if does the amount of intake, does the intake of calories like affect your temperature?
Yeah, of your body.
Yeah.
If you were hypothetically,
if
you were food deprived, your body temperature would definitely be lower. Absolutely. And not only that, you would be more susceptible to a lot of other things like diseases.
Right.
Like,
and the opposite would be true as well.
Like if you ate too much food, would you just keep getting hotter and hotter? You reach a limit because your body's exothermic.
Yeah.
Exothermic, endothermic, we know those words. Exothermic gives off heat. Your body's a natural radiator, and it's exothermic. So if you get to like 100, because you're literally eating too much food, so it would naturally give off that heat, and you would not go above. It regulates the temperature. It's like a monitoring system.
Is 100 the...
An
8.6.
It's like... An 8.6. The body's internal temperature. Right? An 8.6, is that what it is? So your body is regulating an internal temperature. Your skin temperature is not going to change if you go home and eat a Snickers. But your body's internal temperature is what needs to be regulated. It regulates it by using the calories you're eating. Your surface temperature is a function of your environment. So if we were in this classroom and the AC wasn't on, and maybe we were in here for like half the period, I bet you if I did that same thing, you would all read like high 80s for sure. Imagine you're at your track meet or your softball game today, and you measured your skin temperature on the field. It would probably be upwards of like 93, 94 degrees because it's so hot out, so your temperature would radiate over. And you would have that convective nature. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Three modes. Let's get into three modes. Okay? We're going to look at three modes to do work or to give up heat. So I was just using the example of softball. That's exactly what this is. When you run, you're changing your internal energy level. When you do work on something, when you physically do work to it, you're giving it more energy. When I push this eraser across the board, I'm doing work and giving it energy. Where is that energy getting dissipated to? Friction. That's why it stops. So work and energy, as we've seen, are related. Work and heat are related because energy is heat, right? They're really the same thing here. So here's our three modes now. Conduction, convection, radiation. Three modes. Literally, entire courses devoted to each of these. In grad school, you can take engineering grad school. A whole course on conduction, a whole course on convection. I, in undergrad, took a course on heat transfer, which was pretty much studying these three things for an entire semester. Like spending 4 or 5 weeks on conduction. We're gonna spend one period on three of these. You see what I'm saying? I'm really just touching the surface on this, but I'm giving you guys the knowledge behind it so that if you do choose to work in engineering or something where it's thermal management, whether it's maybe it's contracting work or HVAC work, who knows what it is that you do for a living you want to do, maybe you'd have a little bit of background in it so you know. We'll start with conduction. Conduction, the best example, is that when you have contact, heat flows. When you have contact, heat flows. So when you guys touched the desk before, your hand was losing energy because of conduction. So what's happening is this. Molecules vibrate, we talked about this, and they have kinetic energy. More kinetic energy means more vibration. You're moving faster. So when you touch the desk, you're literally speeding up the vibrations of the desk material outward. Now, as you get over here, you're not affecting much. So this vibration affects the next molecule, which goes to the next one, but eventually what happens is it dampens off. That change in energy doesn't make it all the way out here. That's what we're seeing with this diagram. Imagine you put those hot coals on the table of the desk right here. This is going to be really hot. It's going to be hotter or a little bit warmer or a little bit cooler, a little bit cooler, a little bit cooler, and then cold from the very end. This is what we're talking about when we talk about a heat flux. or a change in temperature. High temperature, lower, goes from high to cold, hot to cold, so the direction of conduction is this one for this diagram. Okay, conduction is one of our most primary modes of heat transfer, especially when it comes to losing heat. Windows, believe it or not, these are not. Windows nowadays are double pane, and inside of the two panes of glass is a gas. It's usually a combination of other gases, but mainly argon. Argon has a very low, what's called conductive coefficient. So when heat wants to leave the room, it hits the glass. Glass is a really, really, really easy conductor of heat, so it just goes out. That's why you notice these rooms in the wintertime, they're either really cold or really hot if the heat's pumping. But if the heat's not pumping, they get really cold. Because these are old windows in here. If you go home to your house or apartment, you might have nice new windows that slide up and down nice and easily. You'll see two panes of glass. That gas in the middle is preventing heat loss. It's a conductive barrier. It's like a thermal barrier. As if you had a, you know, like a thermos for coffee. It's got a little air trapped in the thermos. Did you ever know that? If you take a thermos and you drink coffee out of it, here's the thermos, turn on its side, empty it, turn on its side, cut it. So you see the cross section of the thermos, you'll see a metal outside, a metal inside, and then inside of there, it's either a gas or some sort of a foam or styrofoam that easily traps heat because of a very low conductive coefficient. I'm going to talk more in the next class about calorimetry and what they're doing in chemistry as an experiment, and I'll get into a little bit more with insulation in that topic. Maria?
Same as?
I'm pretty sure airplane windows can be reset too. I'm pretty sure airplane windows are double paint as well. Yeah. It also helps with pressure and structural integrity, for example.
Because, like, they've been on the news recently, like, one crack. Yeah. And
I read that whole article that they were dying stuff, and I read this whole thing. It shattered because one of the generators exploded and the window shattered.
Yeah, this is a new one.
Oh.
This happened like
2 years ago. I was like, what was
it? No, it happened 2 years ago.
Crack?
Like it cracked and then started like shipping away.
So yeah, part of the problem with like if you have like a break in glass or wood is it propagates. So a little crack continues to spread. Like, you've ever had your windshield crack? It's a little crack. It spreads over time because of pressure in the glass. But double pane is really for thermal insulation for the most part. It's possible on airplanes with double pane because of safety precaution. One crack should have secondary layers. It's probably both accounts. Because when you're up in the sky, the temperature above the clouds is extremely, extremely cold. Like extremely cold. To the point where if you didn't have a thermal barrier on the airplane, it would probably get really cold inside that airplane. But what things inside the airplane give off a lot of heat? You, very good, Steve, take one like this. You guys do. An airplane is literally warmed up by the people on it. Ever go on the subway, and it's packed, and it's hot, and you're like, oh my God, blame the people around you. It's not the air conditioner. The air conditioner's working, but each one of you are a little heating unit, and you give off a ton of heat. This is the truth. I mean, people survive for a long time by, like, even if they weren't significant others. Even if they weren't, they would sleep together at night for body warmth. It's not like I know you guys have been laughing about it, but it's true. Like, people for a long time, when you had prehistoric times, especially when you would heat things up with a fire, you would literally use another person's body warmth to warm yourself up. Anybody watch How I Met Your Mother?
Yeah.
There's an episode where Marshall and Ted get trapped in the car in the snow. And they've just been like college roommates, and they're like, we might die tonight, we might die. And eventually, what do? They like cuddle together in the back seat. Like, whatever, I mean, it's nothing wrong with that, obviously. But for them, you know, they were just like, they had to do it to stay warm. They woke up the next morning, and they're like right outside of a motel or a motel. But it was a snowstorm, they couldn't see out the window, so they didn't know where they were. They just pulled over, and they woke up in the morning and ran outside of a motel.
It's a good show, it's very funny. Let's go to the second mode of heat transfer. The second mode is convection. You've heard maybe the phrase convective currents at times. A convective current is something that is flowing at all times. How many of you have lava lamps or know what a lava lamp is? Okay, so a lava lamp works on the basis of this. at the bottom, that little bubble of magma, it's not magma, obviously, that little bubble heats up, comes to the top, eventually gets to the top, so it gets to the top, cools down a little bit, sinks back down to the bottom. When you boil water, you're literally doing this. You're heating up the bottom, the hot molecules go up, the cold ones come down. Does that explain why the air conditioner is in the top of the room now? The cold air coming in, what's going to happen to it? Cold air is dead, so it's going to fall. The hot air that you guys are keeping up, what's happening to it? It rises. The air conditioner sucks in your hot air, runs it through a refrigeration cycle, takes the heat from the hot air in a material called Freon, it's a liquid, R134A, it's a liquid that you use in refrigerants. It takes on your heat, which causes that liquid to boil inside the thing. Then it goes through what's called a condenser that condenses the boiling liquid back to a boiling gas back to a liquid, and then it continues the cycle. It's plugged into the outlet because the condenser needs electricity to run to cool off that liquid. That liquid, though, again, is taking your heat. Your heat is rising up, getting sucked in, blowing it off, pumping it back into the room. So you might say, oh yeah, the air conditioner is cooling us off. It's really just taking your heat. It's not really giving you cold air. It's taking your heat and putting back air that is not hot.
So the air conditioner is doing a decent amount of water. It's like, what's the cost of water?
Like, where's the discharge to?
Yeah.
There is usually drips right off the side.
Like, is it part of the process?
It is. There's a condenser in a refrigeration cycle. Look up on, just Google schematic of a refrigeration cycle. You'll see one of the elements is a compressor, one is a condenser, one should be an expansion valve. It depends on the refrigeration cycle, but if you look up like a Brayton cycle, I think, is the one that air conditioners run on. A condenser actually is what is pulling the liquid or the gas back to a liquid, but you actually get condensation on the outside of that, and that's where the water is coming from. It's condensation from the air, rain. Rain, did you know, by the way, you've been out twice on days that it rained? It's been a conspiracy. The one day you were out, it's like, wow, it's raining hard today. And then I realized you weren't here. They were like, maybe rain turns into the rain.
Yes.
But imagine like water moisture in the air. Yeah. That's what's condensing on the outside of the air conditioner, and then it just drips.
Yeah.
But it's not actually coming from the air conditioner, which is on. Okay, it's just the temperature difference which causes condensation. Put a cold glass of water in the room on a warm day, you get all the ring of water, right?
Yeah.
It's a differential in temperature that causes condensation. So that's the second mode of heat transfer. Let's underline this. Let's underline the word fluid. This only occurs with a fluid, apparent. So, you burn your finger, what do? Burn your finger, first thing you do?
Not under cold water.
Possibly. What do? No, initially, before you get to the sink. Yeah, you put it in your mouth and you blow on it, honestly, right? Which one or the other? Usually like this, like, or you cut your finger like that. But if you really burn, you might go, like, you might not, right? But if you have hot food, soup, what do? Blow on it. My mom, when I was a kid, I didn't believe her. I used to tell my mom that she knows she's talking about it. She's totally right. I told her that I don't understand science now. She used to tell me when I was a kid, right? I would, a nice glass of hot chocolate, right? Well, cool down, sit there. Doesn't do it very quick. She said, don't blow on it, just drop a spoon in. Why?
When you feel it, you can tell how hot it is.
Okay, but more than that. Why spoon? Metal is a good thermal conductor. So you have conduction to the spoon, and you have some sort of convection, and you're blowing on it, so both modes of heat transfer are apparent. You look something
that
was sure if you same movement.
It did.
Yeah, the black match with
you.
Did you find it?
Yeah.
Okay. So conduction and convection go hand in hand. When you have convection, I know it's a fluid, but the fluid is technically in contact with you. Run your finger, you said run through the water, right? Run your finger under cold water when it burns. Isn't there contact? So it is convection because it's a fluid flowing, but at the microscopic level on the surface, there's a little bit of conduction occurring as well. So usually these modes of heat transfer work together or come hand in hand. A fire pit outside is mainly convection. Do you touch the fire? Honestly, I hope not, right? Unless it's a marshmallow, that's empty conduction. Maybe that's not. A fire pit is mainly convection. You feel waves of heat coming off. It's also what we're looking at next. Here's what we're looking at next.
Radiation. About convection,
What affects convection is the fluid's pressure, its buoyant force, even though it affects it, its buoyancy. God bless you. And its conductive property of fluid. So again, convection has a little bit of conduction in it. And then for conduction on the previous one, we talked about certain metals are better than other materials. Sometimes we want good thermal insulators, sometimes we want good conductors. It depends on... Okay, radiation is the third mode of heat transfer. So radiation is the third mode of heat transfer. That is what you are doing right now. Your body has a core temperature that is 98.6. The room is 75, so your body is physically giving off heat. When the Earth, when we talk about the greenhouse effect, we talk about like the atmosphere and stuff, the Earth is a radiator. If we release too much carbon, it ruins the atmosphere. Without the atmosphere, we get this crazy ozone layer. It starts trapping heat, and suddenly the Earth's temperature has risen. That's risen a lot. Whether you believe it or not, just look at data. Literally look at data. Go back 500 years and look at the average temperature each year. The temperature has gone up dramatically on the Earth. Because the Earth is literally trapping energy in its atmosphere because of pollution. Literally because of pollution. It's a radiator. The sun is a radiator. So how does energy get carried with radiation? Through waves. Through waves. We talked about transversal longitudinal waves. We talked about EM radiation. That's how it carries energy. So the question in the other class that was posed was, well, is outer space absolute zero, so there's nothing there? It should be like nothing in the molecules? It's not. There's still some heat signature. There's still heat traveling. There's still energy traveling in packets, in photons, in the forms of waves from one object to the other. A fire pit is radiation, where you see the coals and the embers. But when you're off in a second or so, because of the radiation, it creates a temperature differential, and you feel almost like a hot heat wave. You're feeling convection from the radiation. It's both modes of heat transfer when you're at a fire pit. It is not conduction. You're not touching the coals. You're not touching the flames. It's convection and radiation with a fire.
Wouldn't space be like split up like different temperatures?
I'm sure it is. Yeah, I'm sure it is. Absolutely. Like that you talked about the isotherms,
right?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah.
So what kind of waves? Or light?
So it's in the form of, in this sense, these are photons that are carried in an EM wave. So what we're talking about in this case, visible light, infrared light, they all carry some energy with them. Remember we looked at that Cosmos video? Talk about infrared has energy still. So all forms of EM radiation carry energy. So all of them literally will change the energy of the system. Mm-hmm. So you can bombard something with a certain radiation that will change the internal temperature. So anytime you have something that carries energy, it's carrying heat or something with it that can affect another body. So it's not like one answer to the question, but this, the sun physically, it's the photons that are carrying heat energy or light energy that's then absorbed as heat. Now plants absorb light, not for their heat. They don't use the energy for heat, but they still use energy, right? Chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is what turns light into energy, literally. It's an incredible reaction. Photovoltaic cells were discovered, were invented because of plants. Everything we do already exists somewhere. Have you ever seen a fly flap its wings at high speeds? And now we have these little mini drones that can act as like spies? Where's the technology coming from? From nature. Birds fly. People literally studied birds for centuries before we learned how to fly, the Wright brothers. Where did the idea come from? Lift, birds, the wings, the whole idea is there. So what I'm getting at is that yes, it is something that we're talking about here. But the modes of heat transfer are all kind of coupled with one another. You might have more than one at a time. Of course you do. But they're all coupled one at a time. Okay, all coupled to each other.
I think that's it, but let me see if there's anything else I want to add that I didn't mention. Humans, by the way, humans give off energy in the form of infrared. Fun fact. Infrared, because obviously it's not visible light, right? It's not visible light. Let's see, anything else? To give you a little another fact we're looking for, right? If I'm working on a computer, homework's here for me, if I'm looking on a computer, I want the heat to conduct very easily to the fan, and then the fan blows off the heat on the heat sink. Open up the computer, you'll see that literally. It involves a heat sink with a fan running over it. You want that heat to travel through what's called a heat pipe. Look up heat pipe in computers. See you later, guys. Have a good day. Hey, Steve, congrats.
Oh, thank you.
Congrats. It's great news. I didn't even say it.
How are we doing?
You too. Hot milk heats up the cup. Pour it into a colder cup. Heats up that cup. This cup's cooling down. Pour it into that cup. Heats up that cup. This one's not cooling down. So when the cup is empty for a second, the heat that it just heated up with from the milk gets lost behind it. So it's like you're bringing in a new cup, old cup on top. So you transfer from the milk to the cup. Tell your mom, explain to her why it works. That's cool. Yeah, very cool.
Thank you.
Have a good weekend. All right, 10.